I tell you, I love the spirit that makes people do things that they probably shouldn't. Meet Colonel John Stapp. Old Johnny Boy's about to travel faster than a .45 caliber bullet. The plan? To hurtle his body down that track with 9 rockets burning behind him. Basically, he's a human missile. While all the sane people run for safety, Colonel Stapp sits alone. Why the hell would anyone ride this ship?
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3.
Here he is, Groucho Marx.
Well, Colonel Stapp, you're a very important man. Let's get a few vital statistics about you. Where is your hometown?
I was born in Bahia, Brazil, in South America.
In Brazil?
My parents are missionaries.
Oh.
And I came to this country at the age of 12.
John Stapp always took a keen interest in helping the lives of others. But after witnessing his infant cousin die in a fire, he dedicated himself to saving lives. After medical school, he joined the Army as a doctor. The military stationed him at Wright Field, a base known for its unusual experiments. All aimed at advancing aviation safety, of course. A large number of pilots were dying in crashes, so the Air Force looked to rocket-powered ejection seats to save them, but they needed a guinea pig. Dr. Stapp swung into action. He formed a team to study the effects of rapid deceleration upon the body, the kind experienced in a high-speed bailout from an aircraft. With every plane that went down, the body count increased. But Dr. Stapp's research uncovered a shocking statistic. Far more pilots were being killed in their automobiles rather than in their aircraft. Bam! He realized his research might not only save thousands in the armed forces, but millions of civilians. Transportation safety became the name of the game, but he needed to establish a set of standards through trial and error. Field testing was dangerous. It required open spaces and a total disregard for speed limits. Enter the Mojave Desert, the wild, wild west of the aerospace industry. Dr. Stapp was upgraded to Chief of Aeromedical Research in the same place where rockets reached towards space and Chuck Yeager just broke the sound barrier. As airplanes flew faster and performed more extreme maneuvers, reports surfaced of pilots passing out in midair from overwhelming G-forces. To better understand human tolerance to gravitational force, Dr. Stapp would need to replicate aircraft speed on the ground. He found a 2,000-foot track originally designed to test V-1 flying bombs and built a rocket sled atop it. He called it the G-Wiz. If anyone rode it, they wouldn't walk away with dry pants. The first to brave the sled? Oscar Eightball, a 185-pound dummy. Oscar's practice runs showed that proper restraints could prevent the majority of injuries sustained in a violent impact. But Dr. Stapp knew the test results were insufficient when real lives were at stake. It was time to experiment on a human. Dr. Stapp stepped up. Not learning the limits of the human body was risking lives of pilots in the air. Conventional wisdom said that a fatal dose of gravitational force would be delivered at a mere 18 Gs. To put this in perspective, the average race car driver experiences a maximum of 5 Gs while rounding a curve. Dr. Stapp planned to endure 7 times that amount. Top Air Force brass thought that human experiments were too risky, but Stapp insisted. Before his first ride, he was offered a donut. He turned it down because he said a full stomach made a messy autopsy. Ha! What could go wrong?
4, 6, shoot, 4, 1.
Success. The 150-mile-per-hour blast-off only caused blurry vision and general soreness, symptoms similar to those after a night out with your college friends. Remember when I said the human maximum was thought to be 18 Gs? Dr. Stapp nearly doubled that. Let's just say he was a true OG. Run after run, he went faster. He knew that sudden change in acceleration, rather than speed, was the cause for bodily harm. His aim? To know the upper limits of safety, what he called the point of beginning injury. He endured 29 rocket sled deceleration tests, collecting critical data with each. The price of his research? Oh, just a few broken bones and dental fillings being ripped from his mouth. The flight surgeon earned a promotion, but instead of a bump in pay, he got a bump in G's. Before he could flirt with supersonic speeds, he would have to prepare his body. And by prepare, I mean borderline destroy. After much trial and error, Dr. Stapp and his team built a sled that they were confident could safely push a human body to its limit.
The sled is unmanned, but a camera mounted on board shows the terrific friction created. She jumped the track, rocket on a rampage.
Even with all the testing, survival was no certainty. Introducing the Sonic Wind 1. Sled bolts to a land speed record of 632 miles an hour in just over 5 seconds. The ride delivers a force equivalent to 46.2 Gs, increasing his body weight from 168 pounds to a bone-crushing 4 tons. In 1.4 seconds, the Sonic Wind slams to a dead stop. He's the fastest man on Earth. But is he alive? Dr. Stapp is thrashed, but he's breathing. Every blood vessel in his eyes burst. He compared the ride to being assaulted in the rear by a freight train. He had finally reached the point of beginning injury and suffered no permanent ones. His work wasn't done, but his rides on the wild side were.
The fact that a properly shock-mounted human body seated in the forward-facing position can sustain 4 tons of force applied within a quarter of a second and suffer no disability is just as significant for automobiles as it is for airplanes.
Why did you take such a dangerous occupation for yourself?
Well, I received one of those pieces of paper which said, you will report to Edwards Air Force Base and go to work on this.
Yeah. Didn't tell you you had to go 600 miles an hour on a sled. There's only one man who's faster than he is. That's the man who comes home at 3 o'clock in the morning and tells his wife he's been to a PTA meeting.
We do this type of research because we've been losing people in airplane crashes and even in car crashes, and we think that they could possibly be saved from death or injury if they were properly suspended in the cars or airplanes.
Now, how about safety belts in automobiles? Do you approve of them?
I certainly do.
I have 4 of them on my own car. I wouldn't be without them.
I have 6 in my car.
Why, you 600-mile-an-hour rascal, you.
His continued advocacy helped establish the Department of Transportation and the Highway Safety Act of 1966, which required all new cars sold in the United States to install seatbelts.
Buckle up for safety, everybody, buckle up!
This alone has saved millions upon millions of lives. So, what is that spirit that made Dr. Stapp do what he probably shouldn't have?